Yo, what's up? Welcome back to the Motostop Show right here in beautiful Jacksonville, Florida. We're back in our studio. I'm your host, CJ Harris, sitting right alongside me, none other than Dean Diaz the Third.
Thank you. I appreciate that. That was a great intro right there.
Yeah, I almost screwed it all up.
It's all good. I mean,
about flicked everybody off, but it came out okay.
It worked out.
Dean, buddy, how you been, man?
I've been all right. You know, I mean, it's been a long time since I've been on the show, but I'm happy to be here again. I'm actually a repeat guest, I think you said.
So we figured it out. You're the second repeat guest.
Second repeat.
My son, who kind of has an inside and knows people, was the first repeat guest. So, you know, maybe we keep it going. Maybe we make you a regular co-host, maybe once a month, twice a month. Kind of works out when you're training up there at WW Motocross Park and you kind of swing by the studio here on your way home. So I appreciate it. I know hopefully our fans out there appreciate it as well. So, yeah.
Yeah, definitely, man. I love it being able to go up to Jacksonville, of course, W&W Ranch, be able to train up there with some northern kids, then stop here on the way home. It's not a problem. There's always dinner ready for me, so I love that.
That's it. We had a good dinner, and now we're at it. So the fireworks were lit this weekend. Anaheim 1 has came and gone. I don't know if you're as excited as I am, but I'll tell you, I'm pretty friggin' stoked. I have dirt bikes to talk about. I mean, we talk about a lot of local events and maybe Red Bull Straight Rhythm and the Monster Energy Cup and Australia Supercross and Geneva, but nothing like A1 right here in our home country. We're going to dive into this thing deep, but give me your quick thoughts on it, Dean. What did you think of it?
I thought it was pretty awesome. I mean, actually, to be honest with you, I feel like a lot of the guys, they were sort of conserving a little bit because this is the first round. It's a long season. I think all the riders know that. I mean, we got a lot of heavy hitters that were doing well, but I feel like everybody was a little bit at ease at this race, the opening round.
I guess it wasn't the showdown that I thought we were going to have and that I guess everybody was probably hoping we were going to have.
Definitely.
But it definitely was a great race within itself out there, folks. I mean, we'll talk a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about the injury list first. You know, probably the biggest heartbreak out there is Trey Kennard. You know, has an injury in practice, big get off, and then in his heat race as well, qualified fourth in the LCQ and actually made it to the main. What do you think about it?
I mean, I know Trey personally. We go way back with racing and stuff like that. I've known him for a long time, and this kid has the biggest heart, a heart like you wouldn't believe. You know, the things that happened with his father, grooming his track and stuff and passing away and coming back and having some bad crashes, come back from some bad injuries. So, I mean, my heart really does ache for him, but I did hear that he's just going to get a little rotator cuff ligament stuff done in there, and he'll be back for the third round, I believe.
So there we go. So no surgery, just a small tear in the rotator cuff, and then he'll be back. So I got to ask you, something weird happened, though. I mean, the big crash was in practice, so I imagine that's when the damage happened to his shoulder. He lined back up. He raced the heat race. He went back down the heat race. He lined back up. He raced the LCQ, and he got fourth in the LCQ. Then he got dressed, and he came down to the line. They brought his bike down to the line, and they didn't push it in his spot. What do you take of that? What do you think of it?
I feel like it was just a lot of show, you know, making him think he was gonna. He probably had no intentions on doing it at all. They just wanted him to come to the line, you know, to show that heart that he does have, that he really wanted to be out there. And he couldn't make it, but I just imagine, you know, doing the whole night, but that shoulder was pretty beat up by the time the main event came around.
So if you're an average fan out there, and, you know, I consider us not so average, maybe nutcase fans, but if you're an average fan and you do find this information out and you say, okay, well, if he knew early on he wasn't going to race, that's only filling 21 spots on the gate. You know, maybe your rider, whoever was the 23rd, fastest qualifier or whoever got fifth in the LCQ, maybe your rider could have made it to the main. Does that make you a little angry? If that was your rider, would it or no?
I mean, I'm sure as a rider, as the privateer, they get a little angry. But I think they really wanted to try to make Trey make it through because you're losing valuable points if you don't go out there. I mean, what is it? Second to last place, you still get points, I believe. Maybe even last place, you get a point.
I think they pay up to 20, so he wouldn't have got points or... Alessi?
Yeah.
Alessi. So didn't score any
Another
points.
Topic.
yeah. So might as well jump in on that. I mean, now I wasn't there live, and I know yourself wasn't there as well, but case to triple, and from what a lot of other media said, especially on the Pulp and Mech show, that they were there and they seen it, case to triple like they've never seen a triple before. Like he didn't even come close to going over.
Wow.
Straight backside it. Knocked the wind out of himself. Heard he wasn't unconscious, but maybe some cracked or broken ribs. I mean, you ever, Well, I mean, I know you actually came up pretty short on a triple one time in your life, and you decided to bail. I don't know what happened. Could you imagine coming up that short? I mean, a pro rider in a, you know, a race like that, something, bike malfunction? What do you think?
It definitely sounds like a little bike malfunction to me because, I mean, these guys have hit these triples over and over again. It's just like clockwork for them. I think something probably went wrong, maybe even got sideways, had to hit the brakes last second, let off at the last second. And in that situation, personally, if I was going to case a jump that bad, I probably would have hopped off again like I did in Jacksonville because I know the way it feels. If
Captain Moore getting straight out of there?
Exactly. I'm out. I'm gone. I'll see you later. But, I mean, maybe that was, like I said, you got to be in that situation and know it was going to happen. Maybe he thought he was going to be able to get over it enough to stay on the bike. It's one of those things. You got to be in it.
All right, so before we dive into the 450s, why don't we talk a little bit about the 250 class? Oh, wow. I mean, I guess my mind was blown in the 250 class, and maybe not so much by the race in action, but by who won. What was your overall take on the 250 class before we dive deeper into it?
My overall take of the 250 class, I mean, I couldn't really believe it. McElrath came out the whole shot. He won every single lap of that race. I was hoping for the Pro Circuit boys to step it up a little bit, maybe even see some other bikes up in the mix, but McElrath, man, I can't believe how much he had his head on his shoulders and just won the race. What can I say?
I guess you can't say a different level, but he did everything that boy needed to do to take the win. I mean, not only winning his heat race, but coming out there and putting in a great start. Heard some interviews from him. He said all he could do is control what he could control, and that was a start. Came out there, did exactly what he needed to do. He executed everything he needed to do perfect. Got the start and let everything unfold behind him. He looked forward. He ran his race. First time ever winning, and then winning at Anaheim 1. You know, he said his head was like, you know, halfway through, started already blowing up, but he had to bring it back down to reality. And he said, I just kept thinking about what was it like at a practice track, one lap at a time. I'm just practicing. These are just my friends coming behind me. Don't overthink it. One lap at a time. He said, I'd start to get into that routine where, I'm going to win Anaheim 1. And then he had to bring himself back to reality to make sure he hit his marks and continue to focus and not lose that focus and throw the biggest race of his life away. So you're absolutely 100% correct, Dean. That kid came out swinging, and what a phenomenal ride he put on. Mm-hmm. You mentioned the Pro Circuit boys. So we got Hill and the rookie coming out, Austin Faulkner. We talked a little earlier about the wreck. What do you think happened coming through the whoops with the two teammates, Hill and Faulkner?
I feel like, you know, the one just came over just a little bit to maintain the line, make sure, like, hey, I'm here, I'm taking that line and getting it from you. And I think Faulkner just checked up a little bit, you know, it's like looked over his shoulder. No, not look over his shoulder, but you see him look at the rear wheel of Hill and panics a little bit, hit the brakes. I don't know if he tried to think about going to the outside or what, but just totally ruined his rhythm in the whoop section.
Yeah, and either way could go, and I guess we'd only know if we were inside the head of Austin Faulkner, but I'll tell you what my mindset and my view was, especially after watching their heat race, where the Hill was coming up on Faulkner, and Faulkner was riding, you know, not aggressively where he was going to take his teammate out, but he was definitely protecting his inside lines, which as a racer you have to make sure you don't lose that spot. So as Austin Faulkner was coming through the whoops, Hill had the drive. Hill started cutting over, and I truly believe that Faulkner thought he was going to continue to come, let off the gas, and we know what happens when you let off the gas in the whoop section. Your front end dives, and the rest is history. Now, we both watched it probably 100 times, and no matter what the situation or the circumstance was, that kid got extremely lucky.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Luckily, that tough block was there, and you know, you talking about this and talking about him checking up in the whoops and stuff, you know, if he was a little more of a seasoned vet in that class, he might have been able to handle it a little better. Maybe a little rookie mistake there.
Maybe just driving it deep and push him out of the way?
Right, yeah.
Hey, if you don't like who's there, push him out of the way, right?
No doubt.
So, yeah, but again, the heart, he got back up, you know, got himself situated and rode a great race and actually came back to, what did he get there? So he got all the way back up to 8th, and I think at one time he was back to like 16th or 17th place.
Yeah, super impressive. I mean, the kid's going to be hot all year, that's for sure.
He is. So since we got our results out, how about Aaron Plessinger?
Definitely one of those guys I thought could have took it. I mean, he's definitely a hard hitter. He got a good start, but I think he just needs a little more time on that seat.
So I think he had Jeremy Martin. Jay Moore had the fastest qualifying time, but Aaron Plessinger looked good. I mean, you know, he looked really good. And I'll tell you, the biggest difference I've seen breaking the rides down between Shane McElrath and Aaron Plessinger, is McElrath stood up everywhere. I mean, you know, you go to all these riding seminars or these training classes, and you yourself train the top kids in the state of Florida. No matter what trainer they are, you know, when the track gets rough, you stand up into the apex turn, you sit down. As you sit down, you let off your brakes, you get on the gas all in one motion. And Shane McElrath hit that every time. If you go back and watch, that kid was standing up and hitting his marks every time. I didn't notice any other 250 rider really putting in a ride like that, and I think that's what the difference was. But Aaron Plessinger, he did put in a solid ride, and he's big on that 250. Did you notice that?
Yeah, I definitely noticed that. I mean, he's probably one of the biggest kids in the class. I can't wait to see him maybe make a transition to the 450 class next year, because he'll be hot for sure.
He will. So we got Marty Davalos riding out of Clermont, Florida there. You know, he's out at Tim Ferry's Red Dog's place. He's got a third place finish. Another TLD guy in fourth place, number 28, Mitchell Oldenburg. Solid ride.
So impressive with Oldenburg. I couldn't believe how well he rode.
Started out, was eighth place on the start, rode himself into that fourth place position. So a really great ride. The whole Troy Lee design team right there, the KTM, definitely putting in their work. Justin Hill back racing.
Yeah, Justin Hill, I thought that was a pretty impressive ride for him. I know he's overcame a lot of adversity through the years, and I think maybe this year he might be able to put a stamp on that class.
He's definitely doing some damage to it, that's for sure. I mean, the Pro Circuit bikes look really good, as always they do. I mean, for years upon years, they look amazing. All right, well, sixth place, the number six.
Oh, boy.
Jeremy Martin. Yeah.
Let me ask you, I feel like Jeremy Martin should have definitely rode the East Coast. I mean, I don't think he's more of a hard pack, slick track type rider. I think he would have done a lot better with the East Coast, Atlanta, Daytona. He would have been a heavy hitter on the East Coast.
I agree. I 100% agree. I think more time, more testing on the bike. And again, as you know, I'm big into all these podcasts, and I love every motocross information site out there. So something that I've heard quite a few times is that he wanted, at the practice track, he was the fastest out there. So Geico Honda said, it's your time to shine, go.
Yeah.
Put him on the West Coast, right? Then also a rumor is that they wanted to put him on the West Coast. That way they have more time to get ready for the outdoors and, you know, focus on the outdoor championship, which we know that's where his strong point is. Sixth place, disappointment to you for him or what?
I would say yes, but then again, no. Like I said, everybody was sort of riding a little conservative. So sixth place, I mean, it's a good start in the series. You know, it's a long series. Of course, a little shorter for the West Coast, but it's still going to be a long series for those guys.
I mean, sixth place is better than no place.
Yeah, that is true.
So he got points. He finished the race. You know, we talked about this a little bit before we got on the show here live, but what do you think about some of the 450 guys dropping back down to the class?
I'm so glad he just brought that up, guys. I don't agree with it at all. I feel like the 450 has always been the premier class, and they don't have as many riders in that 450 class. Got a lot of young guys coming in, a lot of rookies coming in, kids that are racing their first Supercross for their first time in that class, and here, I mean, they're almost like big bullies. They drop down a class, like, here I am. But, I mean, it's good for people like Kyle Chisholm. Kyle Chisholm, he never really had a very successful 450 career, so he was able to drop down the 250 class and came out of the 10th place, which I think, in my opinion, that's very impressive for Kyle Chisholm.
So let's talk on Kyle Chisholm real quick. We'll dive into this. I told you, I liked his riding style. I liked the way he looked out there on the track, but almost a little timid, if you ask me. You know, I seen some guys coming in that I really thought that he was faster and probably could have battled with and beat them, but it looked like he checked up. Do you think that's all Anaheim 1 nerves being conservative, or is, you know, he just doesn't want to hurt one of these young kids? Or what? I don't understand, because he's not a small guy. He's a pretty big guy as well. You know, and he's got the experience past all of them out there.
Yeah.
Maybe besides Marty Davalos.
Well, I hate to say it because he's doing a 450. He's on a lot of 450 stuff. But dropping down a 250 class, I feel like the pressure is on his shoulders. I feel like he might have got a little tight, been riding a little tight, got a little arm pump. You never know.
Just put in a solid result and finish out A1 and see where we go in San Diego.
Who can complain with that?
Yeah, absolutely, 100%. Phil Nicoletti in 17th place, he dropped down as well.
Yeah.
How about our hometown kid, DeLand, Florida, Justin Starling?
So impressive. I couldn't believe it. You know, he was looking for a bike to race for Supercross, and I'm not sure really who stepped in to help him, but I'm glad he found a little bit of support and was able to get out there and do it.
Absolutely, and actually had a great start, and I'm not sure what happened. It looked like he got into it with Phil Nicoletti. I'm not sure if there was some bike issues after that, but it slowed him down for a lap or two, and then he picked up the pace and hung right back in there. But put in a solid 16th place, and I know that's not where he wanted to finish. I've seen some of his social media, and he's going to come out next week a little stronger and faster. Yeah. So anything else in the 250 class that caught your eye?
Not really much that I know of, other than, I just can't believe how Matt Gregson came out and started to finish, won that thing. I don't want to say he was an underdog, but I don't think he was one of those ones that are expected to come out and win it like that.
I didn't expect him to. I can tell you that with confidence. And I don't think, if anybody stands in front of him and said they did expect him to win, they're probably just lined to blow smoke up his ass, All right, San Diego, who do you think? What do you think is going to happen there?
San Diego, my advice for the riders out there, I know I'm not pro anymore, and I know I don't train any of the pro riders, but Ken Roczen. You got to line up right next to Ken Roczen.
Well, let's go to the stand on 250 class.
Oh, yeah, 250 class. So, all right, Matt Graff, he's the man on the move right now. So, yep. If you're Plessinger, Hill, whoever those guys are, you got to line right up beside Matt Graff because obviously he's got his whole shot styled. You got to get just a little bit of a jump on them, just enough for your handlebars to be in front of his, and come over on him. Keep him behind you. Don't let him do anything.
Mental game?
Yeah, don't let him do what he did in round one, which is start to finish.
Check out. Yeah, for sure. So, McElrath has a chance to win in San Diego.
I feel like Hill's going to do good there.
Hill has experience.
He's got experience, and he's really good with those hard, slick tracks.
Yeah. Yeah, I think we're going to really start to see the riders start to develop and the team start to come together. I would definitely look for Jeremy Martin to be higher. I put Jeremy Martin on the podium. I don't know if he has a win in it. I guess my picks would be Aaron Plessinger. I think he's really going to come through. He was on a move, so I think AP will probably come home with a win. I would say Jeremy Martin either second or third from there. Actually, I'll put Jeremy Martin third. We'll put Austin Faulkner in that second place position.
Wow. That's a bold prediction.
Yeah, I think Faulkner's got it, man. If that kid can just settle his nerves down, I'm a Kawasaki guy. Kawasaki's got to be up there, right?
Well, what about Hill? Hill obviously blatantly went right by Faulkner.
I think it was a mental game.
Mental game?
Yeah. Faulkner's going to turn on the afterburner sun and just blow him away. Going to hit the nitrous button on the pro circuit Kawasaki.
Yeah.
Mitchell Oldenburg, Shane McElrath, and Hill will be in that, fourth, fifth place.
Definitely.
So
who'd you pick for the overall in the series?
Faulkner or Plessinger? I'll say Faulkner right now. If he can stay healthy and he can ride like that kid's been putting in work, I think Austin Faulkner will be our rookie champion. You see a sleeper in there? You see somebody else? What are you thinking?
Martin Davalos.
Marty?
This has got to be his last year. He has the potential to get out there and win it. He's done it before. How long has he been in the 250 class, the lights class?
12 years, I think.
12 years? That sounds about right. That sounds about accurate. But he has the most experience, for sure.
Marty's first heat race in the 250 class, Austin Faulkner was 5 years old.
No way. I can't believe that.
12 years. Faulkner, 17.
I'll have to Google that one for sure.
It's freaking crazy, but that's funny. So, absolutely, he's got the experience. Experience is everything. So, maybe he can do it. Maybe he can't do it. But, if you're just going with statistics alone, the numbers don't lie. In the last 12 years, he didn't get it done. So, I can't put my money on that. That's like keep betting on black when it's hitting on red,
It's kind of trends once, but... My opinion with that, though, is, like I said, he's a seasoned vet in the class, and usually, Martin Davalos, he's in it to win it, he's pinning it, he's all out, he's usually there leading the class and crashed in and getting hurt. This time, he kept his head on his shoulders, and look at that, got a third-place finish. Who can complain with that?
He did, and he's got a solid program under his belt. He is training down in Dade City or whatever you want to talk. He's at Tim Ferry's place. Ferry's got a solid program going, as well as helping Kennard and a bunch of other riders out there. So, his program's solid, Only time will tell. That's for damn sure.
All right.
I'll let you put yours on him.
Sounds like a plan.
All right, welcome back. 2017. Dean.
What?
What are you doing on your phone, bro?
You know what I'm doing, man. I'm subscribing to Big Deal Productions on YouTube.
Oh, we appreciate it. Absolutely, dude. Thank you.
No problem, man.
Hey, all you guys out there as well, since he's doing it right now, make sure you go out there and subscribe to BDP Media or Big Deal Productions. Type it in the YouTube page. Check it out. Follow us on YouTube. You can check us out on themotostopshow.com, Instagram, BDP Media's Twitter. We got it all out there. Just go out there and find us.
I think they got it figured out, bro.
Yes. Well, they don't do it.
Please, guys. Dean did it. You do it.
That's right. From Dean right there to you. He's not begging, but begging. No. So our subscribers are going up, and with that, 2017 has brought a pretty cool thing for the Motostop show?
It's a big deal.
It is a big deal for us. It exactly. is a big deal. So here on the Motostop show, we have some new sponsors coming aboard. Another local suspension company in the state of Florida, Bobby with Pro Action. Looks like he's going to be jumping on board, as well as somebody that's helped me out for in my motocross career, as well as you, a long time. Ronnie down at HBD Moto Graphics, yes. straight out of Daytona Beach. The best graphics in the market. I mean, I know he's been helping you guys and your team. What does he do for you guys?
Oh, we just started using him, actually. I was with another guy, another company, and, you know, he hopped in. He's like, Ronnie's like, no, I got to have you guys on board. I want you to use our stuff and tell me what you think about it. We'll do some testing with you guys. And my graphics, I can't believe it. He actually just did a sign for Orlando MX Park. It's amazing. Great work, Ronnie. Really appreciate it.
Absolutely. And Ronnie, again, has been helping me for years now. And the fitment, everything with HBD Motograph is insanely good. Make sure you check them out at hbdmotographics.com. For any of your vehicle sign needs, any of your dirt bike, high quality materials at the price you want, HBD Motographics is the place to get your stuff wrapped. Whatever, just get your stuff done there.
Well, speaking of that, he doesn't just do graphics. Have you seen his pit shirts? His amazing pit shirts. He does some pit boards for me. He does it all.
The canopies, you name it, the flags, the whole nine yards, he's got you covered for sure. Jumping in, we kind of talked about the 250 class. What about the 450 class?
450 class, just like Matt Graff, whole shot, all the way to the finish. Win, win, win.
But was it expected?
I think it was pretty expected. I mean, maybe not the whole shot, the massive whole shot he had and rode with his head on his shoulders. And, of course, I think on that Honda he has a little more control over, which is a really good thing for Kenny Roczen. He's known to be a little wild.
Absolutely. Now, something I just found out recently, you know this, the Honda is the whole 2017 Honda. They built this bike for hole shots.
Yes.
I didn't know that. So this bike was designed to get hole shots, and it did its job in the biggest race ever. Anaheim won Monster Energy Supercross right here. Ken Roczen comes out. Well, I guess it kind of did its job at the Monster Cup too. You know, he had great starts and was going to win that. But comes out swinging, and just like you said, from the gate drop to the checkered flag swinging, Ken Roczen was unbelievable.
Yeah, he was on fire for sure. I just read an article on him and talking about how he felt after the race and stuff. And just like you said about McGrath earlier, and it's what I trained my kids to do, you got to do everything you can do. Whatever everybody else does, whether they're behind you or even in front of you, you can't control what they do. All you can do is hit all your marks and focus on you and stay humble the whole time. Don't be start celebrating before the race is over. It's almost like trying to catch a ball and run downfield before you even caught the ball.
Well, speaking of emotions and celebrating and all that good stuff, did you see the press conference, press day, with Ken Roczen and the rest of the guys?
No, I didn't, actually.
So, Kenny pulls a 10 out of 10 moves, ultimate swag move, shows up to the press conference in a full suit, looking like Mr. GQ himself, or we could say KR himself. I mean, the guy was on point. Shows up. So everybody's there. You got Dungy, the whole list. Chad Reed, Josh Grant, they're on their team shirts. They got their flat bill sideways hats, getting the gig on, right? Ken Roczen in a nice suit with a purple nice tie, hair's all done, fresh done. He's got a hard cut in it, looking beautiful.
Wow, I'll have to check that out for sure.
Dude, bringing it to the next level, and that's what he said. He goes, you know what? When you watch all these big sports, NBA, NFL, NHL, they don't show up in their street gear. They show up looking professional. We're professional riders. Showed up looking like $1 million. He said his confidence was there. He said his fitness was there. Everything was there. And when the gate dropped, it was there.
It was there.
Ken Roczen was there to play.
Exactly.
Son, 16-second lead.
It's amazing.
It was.
20 laps, it's almost a second lap faster than everybody else, hands down.
Absolutely. And in all his interviews, he said he had more. He said he rode conservative, you know. He said going through the whoops, the track was getting pretty gnarly, getting chopped up, beat up, and he said, I could have went faster through the whoops. I just didn't need to. So, wow. And a very impressive ride. So, a man that didn't have such an impressive ride, and I actually picked him to win Anaheim 1, ET3, Eli Tomac. Probably my disappointment of the whole opening round. What's your thoughts on Eli Tomac?
First of all, this guy, tell me he's insane. Who would go with Eli Tomac, an outdoor rider, for the first round of Supercross? This kid will be coming, but I guarantee he won't be through half the season.
He rides a Kawasaki. He's got to be good.
I don't think that's going to make a difference. But I think, personally, who Kenny's really got to worry about is Marvin Musquin, because he is moving right now.
And he looks good.
Yeah.
He looks real good. But Ryan Dungey?
I mean, he's there. I mean,
second place?
Yeah, but he's just there. He's always there. Is he always in first, second, or third?
He looked good. I'll tell you what. You know, Dungey the Diesel, as everybody will call him, I mean, he was just there. But mm-hmm. he made passes. He had to battle. He had to get around. He actually got around Musquin and Tomac before Musquin could.
Mm-hmm.
So he had the drive and the determination to get up front and try to track down Ken Roczen. Now, time wasn't on his side, even though we're in a 20-minute plus one moto. Time wasn't on his side, so he couldn't do it. And I don't think he had what it took at A1 to run Ken Roczen's speed. But he didn't look bad. It looked like he was on point. It looks like he's ready. I think we will see some bigger battles out of them two later on.
Well, that's always been the Diesel strategy, you know, be right there, runner up, because he's kind of counting on Kenny obviously making a mistake like he has in the years past. But like I said, Marvin Musquin, I think he's going to be the one to have that breakout ride. And that's what it's going to take to break Kenny's rocks, and someone's just going to have to get out there and do it.
Ken Roczen won Anaheim one last year?
I think so. Then wasn't the second round that he messed up on? And
I think so. So, you know, the Diesel wasn't worried about then. He was just warming up the glow plugs right there.
Exactly. You never know what's going to happen. It's a long year.
All right, so back to Eli Tomac, the fade. I mean, it's been a long time since I remember a top rider to his caliber. I mean, obviously, you know, from 10 to 20, they fade pretty good. But somebody to his caliber dropped back as fast as he did. Arm pump, he said. What's your thoughts?
I believe, you know, maybe he did arm pump. I'm surprised he got arm pump, being he's trained harder than anybody I've ever known. But maybe there was some added pressure. Maybe Kawasaki offered him a bonus if he went in the opening round, or he's super expected to win it. Some added pressure definitely would cause arm pump, make him ride a little tighter than normal.
Yeah, definitely. You know, when pressure comes on, you start overthinking it again, mm-hmm. and you know, you make mistakes. Now, here's something that, and this is straight speculation at this point, breaking it down, the first half of the race, he honestly was turning that Kawasaki anywhere he wanted, in and out. When he was trying to get around Musquin and Musquin went high, I mean, he was able to grab brakes, turn it, and go down. Second half of the race, I noticed that he couldn't. He was having to sweep the turns. He was dragging his feet. He was making mistakes just going around a bowl turn. So maybe that's where the arm pump came into play.
Mm-hmm.
Fatigue, whatever the case may be. Now, we know that John Tomac is an intense dude and is one of the hardest trainers coming from the mountain bike background. He's got Eli on this program that's been pretty phenomenal for the last few years. What happens when you overtrain?
I know what happens when you overtrain. I mean, Epstein Barr is what you get, usually, if you're overtraining.
I mean, again, purely speculation here, and I don't want to jump to any conclusions, but Tyler Bowers last year come out swinging. He's good for the first half of the race and then fades.
Yeah.
I mean, to me, that's, I mean, pretty much, unless Eli Tomac comes out and dominates or puts in a good showing in San Diego, I mean, one can only think that maybe he's overtrained himself and he's got Epstein-Barr.
Yeah, you never know. I mean, that's a good speculation for sure. I just feel like he's never been a supercross guy. You know, the nerves were there and things just really got to him. Had it started opening around Daytona, his confidence would have been up here. It would have been a great rest of the season, but he's really going to start working and building that confidence.
Didn't he win a Supercross Lights Championship?
I believe so.
I mean, he's got to be some kind of supercross guy.
Not a 450s. Definitely well, an outdoor guy.
He's definitely an outdoor guy, and I can't wait to outdoors, but right now we got to stick to Supercross. So.
Yeah, it's always fun, though.
Yeah, so let's grab our list here and run down any our results page. Anybody that stands out?
That was a big deal.
Get that riffraff out of here.
Yeah, I hate to see Trey Canard at the bottom, man. That just
it is pretty sucky. It normally comes back firing.
Oh, yeah, always.
So, first on the list, Ken Roczen, you know, with the stats that we have, he's got one hole shot and led 20 laps. Everybody else in the field has led zero laps this year, 2017.
Yep, that's awesome. What about Jason Anderson, though? Started 10th place and worked his way up to 4th. That's impressive. He might be one of those ones that can give Roczen a run.
He definitely is. He's definitely on my radar, and I do think he's got a lot of potential. I think he's going to have multiple wins this year. you know, he's got to get that start, though. Starting in 10th place with the guys he's racing against right now at the beginning of the series, he's not going to be able to work his way all the way to the front. He's not going to be able to make up enough ground from 10th to 1st and overcome that 16-second lead that Ken Roczen or Ryan Dungey or Marvin Musquin is capable of putting down. So we need to see good starts out of Jason Anderson. And
no doubt about it.
Something that he hasn't had always over his time. So
one thing I'm looking at, too, that makes me feel pretty good. I mean, I know it's because the trainers and where they live, but Claremont, Florida. Top three are from Florida. How can you complain with that?
Absolutely not. Claremont, Florida. I don't want to get too deep into Claremont, Florida, because that's where my current RV is at Claremont RV Collision, which is a piece of shop. So don't ever take your stuff there. But if you need training, I guess Claremont RV is where to go. But Baker Factory down there, and got them dialed in and going pretty good.
Well, where do you turn? You turn left to Roczen's, or you turn right to the bakery?
Well, I don't know. Maybe you just jump over the fence.
Whatever works.
Roczen actually on his own program out there. You know, training with another Florida kid, Adam Cincerilla.
Yeah. So. I think Adam's going to be strong.
I can't wait.
I know.
How about in fifth place, Eli Tomac? Big disappointment to me. A great ride, I think, in sixth place was Cole Seeley. The number seven, in seventh place, number 18, Davey Millsaps. I think a damn good showing by Davey Millsaps out there, putting on a great ride, riding with some hurt ribs and some other injuries, going out there, putting forth the effort. Davey's been a guy that had been known, you know, if he's not comfortable on the bike or he has an injury, he doesn't ride.
Mm-hmm.
Coming out A1.
Yeah.
Solid.
I think it's solid, too. You know, big Dave Millsaps comes out to our track at Orlando every time or two, and he's been talking about it, you know. Davey's, he's got this eye on his prize. He really wants this. And I think maybe if he has a good showing here, I know he's considered a veteran now, but you never know. He might be able to score a ride here late in the season due to somebody that gets an injury, or maybe even next year. You never know with Davey if he stays healthy.
Absolutely. He's got the talent. That's you know, huge. And again, I talked to Davey at the big motorcycle show down in Orlando. I actually spent a little time with big Davey, and you know, we talked a lot, and he said, you watch out for Davey this year. And he's right.
Mm-hmm.
Been right so far. How about Weston Pike?
Tell me, what'd you think when Weston Pike was in with Freeze in that heat race? I think it was going to get a little heated. It was the semi. I think they were battling the semi race. I thought it was going to get heated, but they rode a clean race.
They did. And again, thanks to Paul Pimet, does a great job with some media. I listened to all their stuff, and I got some interviews off Paul Pimet. You got to take a time and listen to the Paul Pimet Pulpcast. He interviews Weston Pike at the end of the show. And it pretty much goes something like this. Vince Freeze, that effing bleep, effing this, effing that, effing this. That guy's an effing idiot, blah, 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 blah. That's Weston Pike talking about Vince Freeze and his riding skill. And it's epic.
Yeah.
So make sure you take some time and listen to it. As well as they interviewed Chad Reed, who was behind Weston Pike most of the main, decided it was time to go around them and tried to actually push him out of the way. Rubin's racing, right? A quote right off Pulpimax, it says that, you know, Chad Reed told me that he hit Weston Pike the hardest he's ever hit anybody, and he didn't move. I mean, you want to talk about a solid guy. That dude is intense.
Yeah, definitely. I know that firsthand. I've raced some races with him in the past, my amateur career. I've slammed him a couple times. He didn't move at all. And unfortunately, I've had it in with Freeze, too. He's definitely a dirty rider. I feel like what it is, though, Pike is just a strong rider that's not scared to move and push anybody out of the way, but Vince is just straight dirty, and that's just how they both ride in the pro career.
And if you do actually knock him down, he'll just get up and beat your ass?
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, well, that's what happened in Anaheim 2016. Anaheim 2017, a little better showing for the Weston Pike coming in the eighth place finish. Josh Grant on the factory Kawasaki.
Yeah, that was pretty awesome.
Looking good. And then the rookie, Cooper Webb, 10th place finish.
What do you think? Do you think he should have finished better? Do you think he should have finished worse? Are you happy with the top 10?
I think a 10th place finish, I mean, obviously everybody wants to do better. Cooper Webb, with his heart and determination, we know he's not going to be happy. He probably wouldn't have been happy with a 3rd place finish, but coming into this showing, Anaheim 1 with the big boys out here on the track, he puts in a solid 10th place ride. Now, he didn't look like the Cooper Webb that we've become accustomed to seeing, but he did have some really good speed, came in 10th place, didn't wreck, no injuries, going home with points. Can we build off that in San Diego?
Well, I believe we can for sure. And everybody I've talked to, man, they seem pretty disappointed that he finished 10th. I'm not that disappointed. I feel like it's good. I mean, that's a big step, stepping right into that 450 class.
Would you consider him the secondary rider on the team, or would you consider Chad Reed the secondary rider on the team?
I'd have to consider Cooper the secondary rider just because Chad Reed has such a long legacy, and he looked like he was still better in this race.
I agree. And when you look at the end results, Cooper Webb has the best finish of the night.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess 10th place is pretty good.
Yeah, hit or miss.
Hit or miss. Jake Weimer coming in, filling in for Justin Barcia. Barcia out. Man, that sucks for Barcia, but gets Jake on a bike, gets him riding. He didn't have anything going.
Yeah.
Got to fill in.
That's good. I mean, I really wish I could have seen Barcia out there because I think Barcia and that Suzuki, I think they'll be a good combination. And they would have been definitely a heavy hitter at this race.
Absolutely. I cannot wait to see. I mean, Barcia's one of my favorite riders. I like his riding style. I like the aggressiveness. I like how he lets it all hang out. You know what? I know over revving's not great for Ryan, but when he was on that 250, that over revving is just what made it. So I can't wait to see Justin Barcia come out there, and I hope he does come back out with brilliance and the flash of speed that we know he's got and gives us some good races.
Someone stands out to me, of course, Dean Wilson had that privateer ride coming to 13th. That's impressive. But what was impressive, unfortunately, had some problems out there, is Blake Baggett. Number four, coming out with the fourth place start, having some problems out there on the track and dropping back to that 14th place position. We know that's not where he belongs.
Absolutely not. And I'll be honest with you, I don't really know what happened to Blake. I don't know what caused that drop back, if he got into somebody, if he wrecked, or what the issue was.
And to mention, sorry I passed right by him, but Justin Bogle. I did expect a little more out of Justin Bogle for his first run.
But looking up through the list, I mean, 12th place, who should he beat?
I think he could hang with Steely for sure. I think he could have beat Millsaps and Pike.
Really?
Grant and Webb.
Millsaps and Pike with their experience?
Oh, yeah. It's Justin Bogle. Throw that leg out in the air and let her eat.
I like leg swag. Everybody knows that, so I'm down with that. Yeah. How about Chad Reed? Chad Reed looked pretty good.
Definitely. I was impressed with him. You know, he looked like he was coming in hot. He was definitely firing. As you see here, he qualified sixth, had a ninth place start, then disaster struck for him.
Jimmy Albertson? Moving back to the 450 class, I think that's a smart move for him.
Yeah, he's a big dude.
Coming in that 18th, Nick Schmidt. That'll round out your top 20. All right, so moving on to San Diego. What's your predictions?
I don't know. I know Chad Reed. Guarantee a top five in San Diego.
Really? Guaranteed?
Yeah. Guaranteed top five for sure.
Mark it. Stamp it. Send it off.
You guys go ahead and put in your picks for next weekend because Chad Reed will be in the top five.
I think Ken Roczen's got the momentum. It'd be hard to bet against him right now until something happens. So I'm definitely in my fantasy league. If you guys play fantasy, whether it's Rocky Mountain Fantasy, Motocross Fantasy, the Motostop Show Fantasy League, we got a bunch of fantasy leagues out there. If you play fantasy, I'm putting Ken Roczen first. Gonna probably put Dungy second. I know this is a shocker and probably not too exciting. I think I'm gonna put Jason Anderson third and Eli Tomac fourth. I believe has the speed, but if Eli Tomac, I mean, we've seen him make the pass. He was definitely faster than Marvin, just not able to hold on. Jason Anderson came for all of them, so Jason was closing on Marvin. I think he's got the speed if everything goes right. What's your big wild card? What do you think, who did really bad that's going to do a lot better in San Diego, besides Chad Reed?
Blake Baggett. Definitely would do a lot better.
Seventh, sixth?
Yeah, probably right in there. It'd be fair for him, I believe. I'll tell you what, all you guys are playing all this fantasy league and stuff for motocross or supercross. I don't care if you think you're right. I don't care if you think your predictions are okay. Something's going to happen. Something's going to go wrong. This is supercross, and it's a long season.
It is, but I love it. I'll tell you what, I love it, man. And there's a bunch of different shows, fantasy leagues out there, and I'm in all of them. And here's the best part. I pick different winners for each one from whatever my mindset is at time. I'll get on the Motostop Show Fantasy League and I'll be like, all right, I got this, and I put more thought into it, and I'm on the Rocky Mountain Fantasy League and I'll be like, well, you know, if this happens, this guy can win and this guy can win and this guy, and so then I change it all up.
You know what he's saying is he doesn't like to lose, so he goes to as many sites as he can, gets all his picks, so no matter what, on one of these sites, he's going
to
win.
Anybody that's racing with me knows I don't like to lose. Hell, I in Tampa, racing you in the arena cross, Flush 25 class, one of the stupidest things I ever did. We come off, and me and Dean are side by side, and we have a great start. I believe we're out in front of everybody. Mm-hmm. Dean's on the outside, and CJ's on the inside. And I said, okay, whatever he does, I'm going to do. And as I'm watching him, he grabs third gear and just pins it to the whoops. So I did the same thing. Except for he looked really good, and I didn't look so good. And then I realized I didn't really know how to stop going that fast through these whoops. So I decided to back off, and we rode it out, and everything was good, but great racing. So, yeah, I hate losing, but it's all good times.
Yeah, speaking of that, I might look good through the whoops, but I was on my sister's 250F with 100-pound suspension rating.
And you still won. Thanks, buddy. No problem. You still won. Yeah, make us all look bad out there on a girl's bike.
Well, I think we can all be thankful, though, that John Gurry's chain broke in his plus 35 moto, a moto before.
Yep, that's true, that's true. Speaking of your sister, I seen something she posted up, something about the rule change, she'll now get to race Loretta's. I don't know what happened. Do you got some inside information?
Yeah, I know a little bit about it. The rules changed about the
hold on, time out. Sorry. We probably should introduce your sister.
My sister is Brinsley Dias. She grew up racing, had a great amateur career, turned professional for a couple of years. Had a lot of injuries, and this last one was her ankle, and she hasn't really been on the bike in a couple of years, and that's just where this rule comes in effect. The pro girls aren't able to ride the amateur class, but anybody that has not done a pro women's race for like the past 2 years can ride the women's 14-plus at Loretta's.
Stoked to see her back out there, so now she's got some more confidence and some excitement to get back out there and go for a championship at Loretta's?
Yeah, definitely able to relive it again. That's huge for her.
I'm sure Big Dean is excited now. Oh, yeah. He's going back to the ranch.
You know it. He lives at that ranch.
Yes, he does. I know somebody we didn't talk about.
What we didn't talk about?
Two more guys from the state of Florida that weren't at Anaheim 1.
Me and you?
That's a fact. High five. No, how about... Stewart brothers.
Oh, yeah. Wow. I mean, I did see the thing with James Stewart about he's going to be back. And I've seen this coming even before he was still trying to get rides with the seven graphics that are coming out. He's going to have the seven team. And I can't wait, man. It's going to be so swagged out. It's probably going to be the sickest team ever.
So you're breaking some news here because I don't think that's released yet.
I don't know if anything's released. But
So seven team coming out with their own team.
Well, I don't know if they're going to be coming out with their own team, but I guarantee it's going to be Stewart brothers race right there and Stewart's own set.
Riding together?
I believe so.
Are they both on Suzuki's?
I have no idea what's in the works for that. I know when we went to that James Stewart ride day, they're both on Yamahas, but supposedly they were just trying bikes to see which one they like the best.
Well, I think it's confirmed Mookie's on a Suzuki. I think it would be a little strange if one was on a Yamaha and the other was on a Suzuki.
Definitely, and Suzuki's definitely been opening the doors because they have a couple teams that switched to Suzuki's.
Yep.
Which Joe Gibbs switched to Suzuki's and what was the other one that switched to Suzuki's?
JGR.
JGR switched to Suzuki's.
So let me ask you a question. They come back, they got a truck, they got whatever equipment they need to have to go racing. Say they show up at San Diego.
San Diego, I believe it's still a little too soon. They might wait till it comes to the East Coast a little bit just because they're a little in their home grounds.
I think Mookie said he's racing San Diego. First round they're out, second round they're supposed to be in.
Oh, obviously both in the top 10.
Both in the top 10?
I think we'll both be in the top 10.
When's the last time James Stewart's been in the top 10?
It's been a while.
It's been a long time.
I think he's had plenty of time to think about it.
All right, I hope so. You're actually out of the Stewart compound, so, I mean, you got to see him ride firsthand, see what was going on out there. I mean, maybe he is in shape. Maybe he's got the heart and determination to come back and rebuild his legacy. Man, I would hope for the Stewart brothers top 10, but it's going to be hard with who's on the line
today.
Well, folks, we don't want to keep you guys too long. It's been a long show. Hopefully, we brought some insight to you. Anaheim 1 has been an absolute blast. I hope you guys enjoyed the Motostop show. We enjoy putting these on. And, Dean, I cannot thank you enough for graciously coming in here once again. Hopefully, we get you back in here more and more and more. I know that we got a series getting ready to kick off with your Florida Motocross Series and my Florida Georgia Championship. We come together, we partner, so make sure you guys tune in for that. Looks like the opening round is going to be right there in about April. Yeah, so right after the Daytona Supercross gets done, all the amateur races should be wiped out, and we're going to kick off some local racing here. And you can come check both of us out. We'll be announcing local races, having a great time. We want to thank all the sponsors that came on board 2017. We have some other ones in the works, so those aren't the whole list, but we definitely want to give a shout-out to Bobby at Pro Action Suspension, Ronnie Hames down at HBD, Pam, everybody that works in HBD. They always do a great job, get us hooked up. We want to thank everybody that helps us. All the subscribers out there, make sure you subscribe, make sure you tune in, share it, like it, tell your mother, tell her sister, tell her friend, boyfriend. We don't give a shit who watches as long as you guys watch it, right?
Check it out.
Check it out.
And make sure you guys tune in to San Diego next weekend. That way you guys know what we're talking about. And you can see our input. We can compare with your input and really get things going here.
Yeah, if you guys got a topic, as always, you want us to talk about, make sure you put it in the comments. We'll make sure to address it as we go through these shows here. San Diego coming up. Once again, Ken Roczen's my pick. Mm-hmm. He never gave me one.
Ken Roczen, for sure.
All right, about it. So there it is. Stamp it, Ken Roczen is going to take San Diego. Well, folks, it's been fun. From CJ Harrison, Dean Diaz III, we'll see you guys next week. Peace out.